Young at Heart is brought to you by the Dental Implant Institute of Las Vegas and Canyon Gate Medical Group, an OBDS affiliate.
Fairy tales can come true. It can happen to you if you're young at heart.
The next hour brings entertainment and information for those of you who are young at heart. Here are your hosts, Lynn Peterson and Al Jones.
If you're young at heart.
Hey guys, welcome to Young at Heart. I'm Lynn Peterson along
and
with...
And I'm Al Jones. We are on the air.
Yes,
so we must
are
behave.
On the air. Yeah, so we were caught, you know, acting like five-year-olds, which is a good thing, you know. Everybody should act young at heart.
That's right. 5 years young. Old. Why not 6 to 10?
6 is fun.
Oh, okay.
How do you like our background today?
Hey, I think it's fun.
So
it reminds me of being on an island.
I think a cruise ship. We're cruising along.
In South Pacific, something like that.
Yes, it's so pretty.
And the waves, you know, and just...
It's so gorgeous.
So smooth.
Oh, yeah. I don't get seasick, do you?
It was only one time when I was on the way over to Japan when I was in service.
Really?
That was only one time. Uh-huh. And all the rest of the time I was on the ship, never.
Not a problem.
One time.
Yeah, I think I do recall that happened during a storm or something. Yeah.
It was no storm, though, but it's the first time I'd been on a big ship like that.
Oh.
And so, you know, yeah,
I think
big
you
ship.
Were just nervous.
I think she's giving us orders here.
Goodness gracious, we've got
Goodness
time
great.
Passed.
We have time. We have
Jeez,
time.
Chill out.
Chill. Chill. Is that how you say that? Chill.
Yeah, that's how you say
chill.
It. Chill.
We only have 4 minutes now because we responded to her.
That's right. Well, tell us about it. What is it?
Well, this here is the focus on Channel 46. This is what's going on. You
Absolutely.
Open it up like this, and hey, it will tell you everything that's going on here at the channel here. Inside
here. All the
television
here. Station information plus great coupons. The beauty of this is you don't have to go out and get it for yourself. It will come to you in the mail. Isn't that nice?
It's
we do
beautiful.
Things here to make things less... Thank you. Stressful.
Stressful.
Speaking of stressful,
I
saw a report the other day. It was kind of surprising, but not because you've heard this before, but they went more into detail, and unfortunately I didn't catch the whole thing, but about cell phones and how it affects your brain cells.
You know.
And it actually, they were demonstrating how it really does affect brain cells. It burns them out.
Well, did they not do this when they built these cell phones?
Absolutely.
Did they not research?
But the new... concept now is are people are wearing those earplug all the time.
Bluetooth. What about those?
Those too. And that is even worse
wow.
than using the handheld.
It is?
Yeah. They're just saying now we've just advanced our technology on being hands-free with these phones, but what it's doing to our brain is still frying the brain cells.
Did you see what the experiment they did? I saw this on TV. They took 4 cell phones and they put some popcorn down in here.
Yeah, well, that was
Did
a fake. That
was fake. That fake?
Yes, you have to go and snoop. You can't just believe everything that is emailed
I
to
didn't
you.
Believe it, but I saw this.
You have to go on snoops, people, because a lot of times I'll send these things on to our friends and family and they'll come back, especially my sister-in-law. Mm-hmm. Love you, Virginia. And she'll say, you need to check it on scoops first. And so I'm telling you,
well,
I'm just passing that information
Well, I appreciate
on.
It, but how did they get the popcorn to pop?
We have this new technology now called, what's it called?
I don't know. I don't know.
But the process of faking it.
Oh, is that right?
You know.
Yeah, that popcorn was popping, boom, boom.
Pat said she's been faking it for years.
But she's still young at heart, huh?
Oh, okay. I'm getting a hot flash, I think. We have some great guests on the show again. Flo Provenza, everybody knows Flo Provenza.
That's right. We
Provenza.
Do.
Provenza. She's going to be talking about, the Wild Wild.
Wild Perump. Wild West.
Yeah, the Perump. Yeah,
the
something
Wild
about
West.
It.
Yeah.
We have
Dr.
Tom
Waters, former colonel in the U.S. Air Force.
Absolutely.
Here we go into the wild blue yonder.
So are we calling him Tom or Dr. Waters or
I will introduce him as Dr. Tom Waters.
What are y'all going to be talking about?
We're going to be talking about his past.
And also he is a Newtown board
him.
Member. Which everybody, you know, you work fast, Tom, because you've only been in the Valley 2 years and you're already on the town board.
That's because he's smart.
Were they desperate or were you?
Him smart.
Kidding.
He's
We've got
man.
A wonderful designer in the house. Did
yes.
you notice anything different about me, Al?
Oh, yes. I noticed that you have on, is this not pink? Is this what? Let me finish.
No, because we've only got 30 seconds, for goodness sake.
Oh, yeah, these are beautiful. I love those.
So we're going to be talking about her beautiful designery. Yes. Tracy is in the house with all this. You know who would love these, Tracy?
Who?
Monica on Channel 5. Have you ever seen what she wears? You got to get a hold of Monica. Anyway, and we also have another doctor. Michael Rice.
Yeah.
And he's going to be talking about some
healthcare
stuff.
What's
and
happening to me?
This is what you do when you prepare before the show starts. Yeah. You know exactly what you're talking about.
Yes.
Are we ready for a commercial?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Okay, we'll be back in right after this.
Welcome back to Young at Heart. My guest is Dr. Tom Waters, formerly a colonel in the U.S. Air Force. Is that correct?
Well, lieutenant colonel, but still colonel.
Well, that's colonel. Come on.
Yes, sir. Know. I agree.
Colonel, I mean, come on.
Okay.
That is. And recently selected to the Tom board.
Recently selected? starting the 1st of January. That's
right,
correct.
Starting the 1st of January. But listen, I don't want to talk about that as much as I want to know something about your background. See, because we're both from the same city, Chicago. Great.
Absolutely.
Chicago. But you had some interesting things to talk about your beginning there in Chicago. So maybe you could kind of tell the folks about that.
I would love to do that. I started off in the Air Force right after graduating from high school, Tilden Technical High School on the south side of Chicago, and joined the Air Force. In fact, 2 weeks after graduation, I was in basic training.
Wow.
And stayed in the Air Force for 8 years. Mm-hmm. Went up to Technical Sergeant, which was E6 in the Air Force, and because I had already served in Vietnam, had received the Purple Heart in Vietnam, did not want to go back to Vietnam, I decided to go back to Chicago instead. I took a discharge and went to college. Started college, went to the first Chicago City College, Olive Harvey, and then transferred over to Illinois Institute of Technology and the ROTC program. Got commissioned a second lieutenant.
That's what I was going to ask you. How in the heck did you get commissioned?
Got commissioned a second lieutenant, went back on active duty, and Vietnam was winding down, so I didn't have to go back to Vietnam. And stayed in the Air Force up through the grade of lieutenant colonel. And after 32 years of active duty, I retired. And then went to work for Department of Defense Dependent Schools in Germany. Stayed there for 10 years as a teacher and as a school administrator, and finished up at Ramstein Air Base. And while we were there, my wife and I came back and we were looking for a place to settle down. And we said, Las Vegas is the place. But when we came back to Las Vegas, we couldn't afford the prices. And we were looking at Pahrump, and we found a beautiful home in Pahrump, had it built for us, and that's why we're here, and we're here to stay.
All right. See, because people used to ask me, how the heck did you end up in Pahrump? You know, I said, well, working for the TV station for, 30 years at WGN. And so they had a problem, you know, with my shoulder rotator cuff because I was carrying that camera, big heavy camera. So the doctor says, you know, you need to be someplace where it's hot and dry. Well, I had a few timeshares, and so I got rid of the timeshares. I told the people, I said, hey, can I trade my timeshares for land? I said, oh, yeah, yeah, and I did it just in time because, you know, it's kind of hard to get rid of a timeshare.
Absolutely.
And that's what I did. And I got rid of the timeshare, land, built a house, and away I came. Retired from WGN. You know,
both
like
from
that.
Chicago, both and from we Chicago. Both ended up in the same place.
You know, that's well. Now, Tilden, when you talk about Tilden, of course, I know I'm just a little older than you are, but I used to teach at Columbia College. And I was in the television department, and so what happened there was they were getting ready equipment, going to new equipment. And so the old equipment we gave to Tilden.
Outstanding.
Yeah, gave to Tilden. And I used to come down and try to teach the kids how to use these Sony recorders, how to edit and those kinds of things. So I said, wow. So maybe at that time, I might have been there at the same time. I don't know.
Well, we won't ask what year you were there.
Well, no, don't do that.
Okay.
Well, you could. I was there really actually, and I think that I know you weren't there then because you're pretty close to my age, aren't you?
Yes, I'm pretty close to your
yeah,
age.
My age. But anyway, that was around in the early 90s, on the 90s. Could have been the 90s.
Early 90s?
Well, 90s, yeah.
Early 90s, I was a lieutenant colonel in the Air Force.
Yeah, that's what I figured. See, I know you weren't there then, see. But
no, I wasn't there.
Yeah, but I had a good time. So what did you teach over in Germany?
I was the, as they called CWE, Cooperative Work Experience, mm-hmm. teaching students the life experiences of real work. And I would find jobs for them around the base and in the community, and then they'd be graded by their employer and graded by me. Mm. It went from the interview process to time cards to everything about understanding work. Mm. Now, one of the things that we forget, we teach students, when students are absent from school, they come back the next day with a note after they come back to school. They don't know when they have a job. They have to let the employer know before they're absent, not after they're absent.
Right.
And we don't teach students that. And then we wonder why they don't know.
Right. Were these students members, the Air Force personnel?
These were high school students. And when I was a teacher, it was Army, because I was at an Army base in Germany. But these are students or children of our military personnel.
Oh, wow.
And that was high school.
High school, right.
Yes.
What do you think about the success that you had at that particular time? Were there problem kids, or did you have most of the kids were, say, right on track?
I think in any school system, you're going to have problem kids. But it's the leadership of the parents and the teachers that will turn our students around to make them productive citizens. And that's what we're looking for.
Hmm. What about parents?
We have problem parents, because some parents just want to be friends to their kids and not really be parents. Hmm. And then they expect the teachers to take over the parent role mm-hmm. of discipline.
Wow.
And we need parents to do that, mm-hmm. not the teachers.
Hmm. Now, did you teach also in Chicago? A little bit in Chicago? Because I know you said you were at IIT.
I was at the Illinois Institute of Technologies mm-hmm. as an associate professor mm-hmm. in the ROTC program.
Oh, okay.
And during that time, even though they listed me as associate professor and as a teacher, I was really the Illinois State Admissions Counselor for the Air Force Academy and the Air Force ROTC programs.
Wow.
And my job was primarily PR.
PR.
Appearing on radio and TV to talk about the Air Force Academy and the Air Force ROTC program.
Mm-hmm. Now, there's something else that you had said that you, at the one particular time in your life, you wanted to be an attorney. You wanted to be a lawyer. So what happened there? You could tell me about that.
I love the law. And something I don't talk about much mm-hmm. here in Pahrump is the fact that, yes, I was accepted by two law schools, Ole Miss and University of Illinois. Mm. I accepted the University of Illinois, and I was waiting for the Air Force at the Pentagon to give me the okay to attend law school, because I was still on active duty. I was a young captain at the time. And we didn't get it. There was a mix-up in the paperwork at the Pentagon. The commander at Columbus Air Force Base in Mississippi, he said, Tom, you've been accepted to the law school, you've been accepted by the Air Force, so we need to get you there. So go and we'll take care of the paperwork. So I went to the law school, I'm in class, I've got my apartment there, everything is set up, and 3 days into my class, they called back and said that I had to come back because they were short of aircraft maintenance officers and I could not go to school that year.
Oh no.
So I never got to go back to law school.
Oh, no. Well, you must understand there, Doctor or Tom, you must understand that it's never too late. Why don't you, even though it may take you 10 or 12 years at this juncture, go back? No.
Well, since I received the doctorate, I decided that I would try to do some other things, and mm-hmm. one of them happened to be the town board.
Town board. When you talk about going back to school, was that difficult, or did you go to school continuously once you started?
I have to say almost continually once I started, but once I got my master's degree, it was 20 years before I went back for my doctorate.
Come on, 20 years?
20 years.
Whoa!
I got my master's in 76, got my doctorate in 96.
Wow. See, because my bachelor's, I received my bachelor's after 8 years, but I was off and on police, I was a policeman, all that kind of good thing. And once I received my bachelor's degree, I decided, hey, let me go on for the master's. Now, the master's, it only took me 3 years.
Yes.
Just 3 years, you know, for master's. And then I said, well, should I go for a PhD? I started, but the interesting thing was my instructors were in Germany. And I said, it was online, so I don't know about that.
So that makes it more difficult.
That's what I was thinking.
Yes.
Online is a little more difficult than if you...
It's much more difficult because you're not in the classroom to ask mm-hmm. those questions
right.
that sometimes you need to ask.
Oh, very good. Is there anything before the time, you know, is up that you like to leave with our audience, leave with the kids, things that maybe they should know? Because I know you are a world of knowledge.
Well, I don't want to claim all that, but I do want to say that for students everywhere, you need to know that education is important. A lot of times we look back, and many people will look back and say, I wish I had done it differently. You have a chance to do it differently right now. You have a chance to stay in school and make the best of it. Don't give up, because 10 years from now, you'll look back and say, I wish I had, and that's the wrong time, and it's too late. So do it now.
Well, you know, I've always have been interested in learning new things. And I've learned so much over the years. When I tell people everything I can do, they say, I don't believe that. I say, yeah, look, I learned to play the organ. I even play the organ now in the church.
That's great.
Before service started, play the organ. Then I say, well, I'll sing in a choir and do this. But you're never too old or never too late to do anything.
That's correct.
And I strongly, like you said, I strongly believe that. And I want you to know I really appreciate you coming in, talking to us, and giving this information. Look forward to seeing you again.
Absolutely. Be glad to come back.
All right. Take care. We'll return after these messages. Don't go away.
Welcome back, folks, to Young at Heart. Our next guest, of course, is a historian of all things Pahrump and desert. That's what we're going to call you, Flo. I think everybody knows
a desert rat.
You're a desert rat for sure, but a beautiful one. So,
well,
and you don't look like a rat for sure. But you've got some interesting stories to tell us today about the wilderness here and around the Pahrump Valley, and it's just fascinating. And Flo brought some incredible pictures. So why don't we just start out a little bit about what was it that draws you to talk about the nature and the wilderness of this area?
Well, I just started going back out into the desert again like I used to when I was younger. And I realized what there is out there. Mm-hmm. You just take it for granted. It's a lot of sand and rock and not much else.
Right.
It's amazing what's out there. Absolutely amazing.
And with your artist eye, you probably pick up on things quicker than maybe some of us do?
No, it was more because of the people who have spent their time studying it.
Okay.
And are able to tell you about it.
Mm-hmm.
So I took some pictures. I wrote down some things here, which I'll repeat later. But the last thing that I went on out there, I went out there with Brian. Do you know Brian Brown?
Okay.
The road from here to Shoshone
mm-hmm.
is was called the Brown Road, Charlie Brown Road.
Okay, so we're not
That's
talking
375.
372 or
372, whatever.
So
it
that
is.
Used to be called the.
It was the Charlie Brown Highway.
Okay, okay.
And there is still a Brown out there, a couple of them.
Now, for people that might be interested, and we'll talk more about this, is he still doing tours, or
he's doing tours.
Okay.
He's doing tours now. And Brian really, he grew up there. His grandparents were the first ones that bought land there. And that was where the China Ranch is.
Gotcha.
That's part of that. But they owned a lot of land out there. So Brian spent all his growing up years going back and forth from there to all these different places in the desert. So he's phenomenal about it. And a lot of what we used to take our kids and run around out there mm-hmm. is private ground in one way or another. When there was no one there, it didn't matter if you went there.
Right, you didn't have people telling you, you
that's
cannot
right.
trample on
and
this
you knew
and leave it
that,
in.
You knew that you had to tell your kids you don't touch a thing.
Right, yes.
Which
leave it as it is.
Today is no longer that way.
Really?
A lot of it's destroyed.
Oh, my goodness.
A lot of it's destroyed. So they have the Amargosa Conservancy.
Right.
And that's the one that my daughter Donna works for. And they're trying to preserve a lot of what's left there.
Well, I think a lot of it has got to be education. We have to educate people, and that's why these tours are so important, is so you can.
Okay, so we'll start out with the one picture, which is not in the desert, which is the
large one, Jeff. I think Flo wants to talk about that. There we go. This is, where is this area?
This is the Trout Canyon Road.
Okay.
It goes up to privately owned land. Mm-hmm. And there are a couple houses up there, a few houses up there.
Yeah, I think I've been up there a time or two. It's a gorgeous ride.
I love it up there.
We might want to keep the picture up just a little longer because I know you want to tell or show us or explain some of the events. So you're looking from Trout Canyon.
I'm looking west from up near the top.
Okay.
And I had to climb the hill to get up on where that last little tree is.
So tell us a little history then about what we're looking at, what drew your attention.
As you come up that road, if you look at the picture, you can see way in the distance the very last mountain. Mm-hmm. And along the edge of it, it's a little lighter. That's where the dry lake bed is.
Yes.
Now, that's California.
Okay. Now we all, thank you, Jeff. We all know that there's a dry lake bed out there where anybody can see it driving into Pahrump. The history behind that, what do you know a lot about that? Or
no, that no. was dry a long time ago. It was, I think, part of what they called the White River. Uh-huh. But at any rate, that is like a dividing line between us and California.
Oh,
as you come up there, that was the Spanish Trail.
Really?
Yes.
Jeff, show that picture one more time so we can just show. So that actual road that we're looking
at.
At the bottom. Was the Spanish Trail.
Now it takes off of the highway coming into Pahrump.
Right.
And you can go off onto the left and go back behind that mountain, and that's where you go to Tecopa.
Okay.
And then if you come this way, a little further down the highway, it's Trout Canyon Road.
Got it. Wow.
Up in that Trout Canyon area, there were two men, brothers.
Thank you, Jeff.
I understand their name was the Williams brothers. And there's a cabin up there that's made out of dirt and logs. And it's been up there a million years. It's falling apart very badly.
Uh-huh.
No one takes care of it. I guess the government. It was all BLM land before. Now it's Forest Service, completely different. That cabin is still there.
And you said it's probably circa 1800s or something?
Oh, my God, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah. They raised horses for the covered wagons and the soldiers and stuff like that. But at one point, now this is all hearsay from old people when I was young. At one point, they went up there and they burnt out the stables or anything that they had there, and kind of the Indians didn't want them there because that's where people were coming from to come through to the west.
Yeah, and they were trying to avoid that. Now, we don't want to run out of time, so let's go on to the next
picture. All right, we'll go on all the way over through Tecopa.
Right.
Or you can come up to
this one there.
Up here to the highway and take this 372 and go to Shoshone that way.
Okay, now what are we looking at here?
Right now, you're looking at in back of Shoshone, there are places where when they heard that there was silver,
right,
people came out here with families and no wood. I mean, what are you going to do? Go all the way up to the mountain, cut a tree, and bring it all the way down there?
No, you're not. So what
they
made
did
homes.
For logs, but they dug into that earth. They found out that the dirt there doesn't collapse.
Right.
It's almost, and yet it's soft.
Show the next picture, Jeff. It shows an interior of one of the caves.
Those holes have doors on them.
Wow.
But on each door, there's a little window on almost all of them. And the only way, if you put your eye to that, all you'll see is black. But if you put a camera with a flash and take a picture, you can see inside how they dug out rooms.
And that's how that would be their home. So obviously they brought at least one tree to do the door, or half a tree.
Yeah, they could bring something.
Maybe they found a tree, I don't know.
Yeah, they hauled logs. They had to have some logs. But
now let's show the other pictures. You've got some with footprints.
Behind that, there's another hill.
Okay, that's what we're showing then is this.
You're showing that, okay. A lot of people went out from there. And on that particular mountain, if you see that last ledge, there's a little dark spot on it. Those are part of fence posts. There was a family living there Actually, probably up until about the 40s.
Oh, wow. Yeah. And you wonder how people survive. I mean, we're talking desert. We're not talking
big
supplies of water, shade, shelter, food.
But you'd be amazed at what's out there. There's a lot of water out there.
Is there?
The Amargosa River runs like a U. At one time, there was a huge lake. And someday I'll try and get a
Well, I've seen pictures. If you have been out going towards the pupfish farm, you've got that little lake or that pond. I guess it's a pond now. It used to be a lake. Is that the one we're talking about?
No. Those are mostly little ponds that pop up.
Got it.
But the Amargosa is still underground.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And it still runs underground.
Amazing.
So it isn't too hard to get to water. And there are so many places where you can see the water.
That's
and
amazing.
It is
in
so
our desert,
beautiful.
Yes.
It is so beautiful.
Now, I'm interested in what you found.
These are up on the dry tops where the miners would start to dig. And they'd get to a certain point where it must have been a mudslide or something they were digging in.
Uh-huh. I'm sorry. Getting ready to sneeze. It's like, okay, don't sneeze.
Go ahead and sneeze.
No, it's all right. If I do, you know.
Anyhow, these prints were found, and they're like cement.
Shut the other. Oh, okay, now, they're footprints.
They are footprints. Now, that one is about the size of a horseshoe, a little smaller, shaped a little different, more like a camel.
But we're talking.
But no one knows what it is, and it's like cement.
How many years ago did these?
40,000 years.
No way.
They can go in and
serious?
They can find the time.
Seriously.
From what's there. Seriously.
So kind of similar to like the trees when they, you know, you see
well,
by the rings of the
wet.
Trees.
It was wet at a layer that was like
oh
after
my
it was
gosh.
Wet
That's
and
right.
made tracks, and then they just laid there and dirt collected on top of them.
I tell you, we're running out of time. We just never have enough time to talk about this history.
Show the next one.
That was it. That one, the same
that
thing.
That one is about this big around.
So it's huge.
Bigger than an elephant.
Bigger than an elephant.
And they thought that there were woolly mammoths out there. And they found some bones, but they're not woolly mammoths, and they don't know what they are.
Well, we're out of time, but as always, you got such interesting things to talk about. So we're going to bring Flo back again. I want to go more into this.
I have to say another word, April 16th.
April 16th is the walk?
I have a phone number. There's a walk for another one where the water is.
All right.
760-852-4339.
Okay, thank you. And remember that, April 16th. We'll be back. Welcome back. Our next guest is Dr. Michael Rice. Thank you for coming. And he is a different type of doctor that we're going to be talking about, all these wonderful homeopathic and naturopathic medicine and spiritual psychology.
Right, yes. Yeah, actually, the workshop that we're going to be doing here locally in Pahrump on Thursday night, there'll be a free open workshop called Why Is This Happening to Me Again and What You Can Do About It.
Absolutely.
And we're going to look at the ancient Aramaic idea of forgiveness. We're going to give people a tool for how to forgive. And we live in a culture that gives us a Greek idea that, you know, if I'm in pain, I'm a victim and it's all your fault. You know, you did that terrible thing that caused all this pain inside of me, but it's okay, I'll forgive you. Which, of course, does nothing to change the source of the pain that's inside of me. In the ancient Aramaic, you'd never be invited to forgive another. You'd never be invited to forgive yourself. You'd be handed a tool with which you go inside yourself and remove your pain. So the Aramaic idea of forgiveness is how to change what's going on inside of you. And if you never learn to change what's going on inside of you, then you get to live out the title of my book, Why Is This Happening to Me Again? Because once it's inside of you, until you can get rid of it, until you can remove it, it's going to replay over and over and over again.
I think all of us have seen that happen in our lives, and especially, you know, in the last 3-4 years with all this going on with the economy and people, you know, losing their homes or starting over. And it's like, why is this happening to me again? Yeah. You know, I spend so much time working to build it this way, and it crumbles like a house of cards. Is that part of your philosophy too, is teaching people how to change direction of, if it doesn't work, go a different direction? Or is it all just what is inside?
Well, when you look at, you know, probably the greatest atrocity done to us as human beings down through the ages and that we've bought into is we've had hidden from us the fact that you and I are by nature creators. We create what happens in our lives, which is an idea everybody loves when the creation's going well. But when the creation's not going so well, don't we know whose fault it is? It's always them. They did it. It's all their fault. And if you've got somebody in your life and you think, if they'd just be different, my life would be okay, you're making a big mistake, because what you're experiencing is what's happening inside of you. You
know, so we can't blame our politicians anymore.
We can't blame anybody. No, we chose the politicians. We need to make new choices.
You're absolutely right.
Actually, there's an interesting, you know, the core of the work that I do is based in the idea that a human being is made of a specific substance. Have you ever held a newborn child?
Yes, a lot.
If you were to describe the essence of the newborn child, what would it be?
The essence of a newborn child.
The essence of the newborn child.
Essence. Peacefulness, freedom, or, you know, just this awareness, not awareness, but peace.
The awesome presence of love, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
That's awesome. Human life.
Okay.
That's what we are. Mm-hmm. Every one of us, everybody watching this show right now, whatever your culture's told you, the stuff you're made of is love. But when we come into the world starts to put its generational thumbprints on us. Mm-hmm. And as it does, we buy in and we give up our direct experience of love, our human lives, to buy into something that we're not. We buy into images, ideas that are false. And when we create out of those false ideas, we create falsely. Mm-hmm. And because of the way the human mind works, and we'll describe this exactly in the free workshop we'll do Thursday night at the Senior Center, the way we play the game is we deny ownership for what we've created. Mm-hmm. One of my favorite tongue-in-cheek lines in my workshop is, if they're the one with the problem, why are you the one with the pain?
The suffering. You're
something
suffering.
About that doesn't make
they
sense.
They don't look like they're suffering.
Obviously, if they're the one with the problem, they'd be the one with the pain.
Absolutely.
So it must be something going on in you.
Right.
And so when we deny ownership, what happens is we create an unnatural condition. We create what we call a dissociated mind. Mm-hmm. And once I create a dissociated mind, I can't change my behavior. I can't change what's there until I know how to collapse that dissociated mind.
Can I say this, or does this have anything to do with this? There's nothing either good or bad, but thinking makes it so.
Makes it so. You've got it. Be transformed by the renewal of your mind.
Yeah.
They knew.
And it doesn't matter at what stage of your life you can change. Your philosophy is you can change it. Change yourself.
I've seen people, you bring to mind a woman who was in her 89th year. She'd had a stroke a year before. She had gone through a year of therapy, and as a result of her stroke, she could get her arms up about that far. She came and did the work that we do in an intensive, a 9-day intensive format, where we do just a huge amount of forgiveness work. We do a thing we call responsibility communication. We do empowered to heal. We look at purpose and tying into those energies. And by the time she left after 9 days, this woman at 89 was clapping her hands over her head.
Wow, that's amazing.
All the physical therapy in the world for a year didn't touch it.
But she was buying into what we're imprinted of.
Plant a seed,
and it grows.
Yeah, you know, in the ancient teachings, they said, "Ask and you receive." Mm-hmm. If I've received, I must have asked. Mm-hmm. Well, no, I didn't ask. That wasn't me. Well, as long as you deny that part of you, then you can't find it and you can't change it. Mm-hmm. Forgiveness shows you how to get to the part of you with which you create the result.
Or a lot of times, maybe people feel like, "Well, I shouldn't be asking because that's a selfish approach." And you're trying to teach it's not selfish.
It's not selfish.
Wow.
Can I do a meditation, you know, with positive thinking and thoughts in my mind in order to change this?
Well, one of the things I describe in my book, and by the way, you can go to my website and download the book free in English, German, Russian, Spanish, and Farsi.
Wow.
We've got 3 or 4 other translations on the way, but the book's free online as our workshops are free. One of the things I describe in the book is the disease I call premature positive thinking. Positive thinking on top of a negative foundation won't work, because you'll build to the limit of the foundation with your positive thinking, and then the building's going to fall over. Hmm. The work is you go in and you shore up and clean up the foundation, then positive think your way to the stars. But you've got to have a foundation to carry that positive thinking.
And that's where your tools come in.
Yes, that's exactly it. And the forgiveness process is how you go inside yourself. And it's interesting. I'm the director of a foundation that's translating a copy of the oldest known New Testament in Aramaic, its original language, into English. And, you know, in the West, we say it's all Greek. And The man named Yeshua, if he sat in most churches, would say that's all Greek to me. Because it was Aramaic.
Right.
And it's the root language of at least five of the world's major religions. Not because it's a religious language. It's a physics language. It's a psychological language. Mm-hmm. It's a genetic language. Okay. When they said the sins of the Father will be passed, yea, unto three and four generations of those who hate me.
Now, where did you get your teaching? Where did you gather all this information, or how did you come to this conclusion?
Aramaic.
Just you started studying the Aramaic?
Yes.
Okay.
And there's just, it's physics. My background's electronics with a side study in physics.
Okay.
So when you go to that idea that I just quoted, the sins of the Father, the word sin in Aramaic is not what the Greek cultures made it out to be. It's actually an archery term. When you fired at the target and you missed the bullseye, the scorekeeper yelled sin. You're off the mark. Like, take another shot.
You're off
not identify with that.
Oh, wow.
And
okay.
So when they said the sins of the Father would be passed, those things that we don't resolve within us are literally stored in our genetics and passed to the next generation. And on and on and on it goes. Until somebody says, I think I need to crack the code of the generations. I think I need to open my genetics and remove this generational error, this energy that's off the mark. Now I recreate my life instead of living according to the family pattern. They just knew exactly how it worked. It wasn't about theology, it's just here's how the process
so
works.
So we are the creators of our heavens and hells, by the way we think.
You've got it. Yes, sir.
Well it goes along with that free will thing. It's like if we believe in the philosophy of Christianity, is you were given free will to make choices.
Absolutely.
Good choices, bad choices, whatever. And, you know, if there's a way to crack the code where you can recreate your choices to not continue that pattern, why the heck not look into it?
There is a specific technology, a step-by-step, and people will leave the workshop on Thursday night if you want to pick up a copy of the flyer.
And we're going to tell you where again and when it is,
right,
and everything, because it's free. My goodness, it's free.
Yes. And people will leave that workshop and they'll have a specific worksheet, step-by-step, here's how you crack the code of the dissociated mind. Here's how you get to
how
the core.
How hard is it? Is it a really
it's
simple
process? It's
so
simple.
So why aren't we doing that more now? What's keeping us from doing that? What, is it just our own stubbornness?
Well, if you go to the Aramaic language, the word resistor, or pardon me, the word Satan in Aramaic is a lowercase word, and it means the resistor, one who misleads. When you ask me to be responsible for my pain, I have to feel, I have to deal with my pain.
Right.
And what most people do is go into resistance saying, no, no, Charlie, well, yeah, last year it was Bill. Well, the year before it was Harry. Well, 10 years ago it was Mary. There's always somebody else.
I got it.
But I'm the only one that was there every time. It's about me.
Yeah.
And there is a way out of the Aramaic to crack the code. It was lost 2,000 years ago. My wife and I travel 6 to 10 months of the year. Our travel workshops are done free. We're going to be in Las Vegas next week doing a full five-day series.
Five free seminars in Las Vegas. And let's get to that before we do run out of time. That's going to be at the Unity Center in the Valley. And that's on Pecos Road.
Right.
And they can call this phone number to get more information. It's 702-435-3289. Got to call it if you're interested, because this is more than just cracking the code about why is it happening to me. You've got things in here for healing, keys to health, and power to heal, and power and commitment. And again, this Thursday night, April 7th, from 7 to 9:30 at the Senior Center. Free shop. Go and see it. We'd love to have you again.
Delighted. I'll be back.
Thank you very much, and we'll be back after this commercial.
Delighted.
Welcome back, and I am with Tracy Boshi from Ring Candy, the designer and the lovely lookalike of Audrey Hepburn from Tiffany, or Breakfast at Tiffany's. And as you can see, I'm displaying some of her beautiful designs on my stubby little fingers. I don't know how close up you want to get, Al, or not, but there are some incredible designs. Oh, look at that. That looks not bad at all. Even the hand doesn't look that bad. There we go again. I don't know which way to turn. Gorgeous, gorgeous, gorgeous stuff. So Tracy, I've got to ask you, number one, why rings? How did you get to the rings? What brought you to do designs?
Well, I had a love of costume jewelry and was always looking for new fun things and was having a lot of different costume jewelry that I'd find, and I'd be shopping around, and then I'd have different rings that I'd find that were great pieces. And I thought, what better than to make some of them into rings? I was going to different antique store. I actually went to an antique store, and I saw a couple different pieces when I was shopping for something else, and came upon a couple brooches and thought, wouldn't they make great rings? Because I like the big costume fun type of jewelry, so I thought, wouldn't it be great to transform them into rings, since that was kind of my thing at the time. So it kind of started from that point, and it took off, and I would go to different antique stores and find different pieces and make them into rings, and that's how it all got started.
And it's so cool, because we're going to show some of the designs that we've just put this whole plethora of jewelry here on the table. So if there's a favorite piece you want to tell us about or a story from all of these, you can just pick it up, and we'll have Al zoom in. Al's being our cameraman today too. But this is such fun stuff. And you just got started, or have you been doing this a while? Or
well, I actually started probably the end of 2009. I started, okay. And have it's a side thing that I do just for fun. And decided after I was wearing a lot of the pieces, I would have people come up to me and tell me how much they love the rings. So I decided, why not go ahead and start a business and make them and sell them. And the goal behind it when I originally started doing it was to create fun pieces for everybody to enjoy, so women can feel a little bit more confident and sexy and fun by wearing something that's a little bit that stands out a little bit more. And I thought, what better way than to give people different options, whether it be something like this that's a little bigger piece. I do a lot of flowers. And
we're going to zoom in on that one, I think. Try to get that one. There we go. That looks great.
These are a lot of fun pieces of different flowers that I do. And you can see another here that is the silver and the blue. And then there's also a variety of smaller ones as well. As you can see here, there's different types for all types.
Trying to get the other flower,
For all kinds of people. You can see that not everybody will like the big flower rings like I like to wear. I like the big flowers.
And then you've got also the smaller ones in the, the silky.
I actually just started doing these, a little different take. These actually are not vintage pieces, the flowers, but I started doing the silk flowers and thought that that would be something fun for the summer. And that's actually another, a new line, I guess you could say. And I started doing smaller ones and the larger ones. Not everybody likes to do the larger costume jewelry. Some people like the smaller dainty. Mm-hmm. And that's why I created a different variety for all different types of people.
Oh, yeah. And they are fun pieces, because I've been having so much fun this morning just playing. It's like playing dress up and almost, and the pieces that you have found are just incredible. And you must have fun going around to all the antique stores and just shopping.
Yes. And I think that it's great to reinvent jewelry that was vintage. I love vintage clothing myself. So I believe that, bringing back the old and making it new again is something that's really great. And when you look at all the different pieces that we have here, you can see that it's so eclectic and so many different designs, and it's a lot of the pieces are very well made. You can see that a lot of the vintage pieces are very well made, and from back in the day, you see that it was great quality. And a lot of times you necessarily don't find that today in some of the jewelry that you buy. So that's why I think it's great bringing back some of the old and making it new again, because what better way than
recycle,
basically recycling. And then a lot of the flowers, the bright colors for summer, and then down there we have some of the butterflies as well.
A
wide variety for young and old. Appeal to everyone.
I'm trying to get all these in, and the butterflies are flying away. Woohoo! No, but, I think I'm getting in the way of myself. Let me take off some of these rings. Now, the other beautiful thing about these rings, they're adjustable.
Yes, that's the other great thing. For myself, I kind of have a little bit of fat fingers, as I like to say. So
me too.
So I found that a lot of the rings that I would try and buy, I could never buy because they would never have my size. And that got frustrating to me. I'd love a lot of pieces of jewelry when I go into the stores, and I couldn't wear them because they wouldn't fit my finger. So when I started making the rings, it was very important to me to make them all adjustable. And Let me grab one of these. It's easy to see. You can see that on the they are all adjustable, but another point when they're adjustable, a lot of times they pinch the bottom of your finger.
Right, right.
And these are all top adjustable, meaning that the ring adjusts at the top instead of at the bottom, so it's not going to be pinching your finger. So
absolutely,
that's a great thing.
And I can attest to that again, and I'm going to show you these beautiful butterflies because how many pieces have I tried on today alone? And not one did I pinch my finger. And I've had that happen with adjustable jewelry. But these are great. I mean, do you ever see yourself going into earrings or necklaces, or going to stay strictly with the ring line?
Right now it's rings, and for me, I was doing a lot of the vintage jewelry, and I still am, and converting that into rings, and now I've kind of branched off into do the flowers. I'm coming up with different unique items that I can turn into rings. I can see anything. And right. When I'm out shopping and think, could that be a ring? So I just think you have to be creative. And for me, branching off and doing different styles of rings, right now that's what I'm going to stay with. And I think it's almost my signature trait.
It is. It is. And it's funny because I was thinking at the time, because I'm a big person being an entertainer and you're holding the microphone and I would wear bracelets.
Yes.
That would be like my signature piece because you're entertaining. You want to have a little bling there. But this could be the new mic holder. You know, the ring thing. It's really, it's a different look. It's creative, it's fresh, it's new. Mm-hmm. Do you have a website?
Yes, it is www.myringcandy.com.
That's
so
easy.
My ring candy.
Yes, myringcandy.com, and she's got the cute little cards. And so you said you started this in 2009, and it looks like you're going to have all these crate ideas keep rolling off your head, like going in the flowers, but you'll keep the main line called Ring Candy, right?
Mm-hmm.
My Ring Candy. And have you started selling out here, or you're going to get the line not only through your website, but are you going to start retailing it with outlets and outlets?
Yes, I'm currently in the process of working with some different salons, retail stores that I'd like to get the rings featured in. And then I do online sales. And then also, if people are interested in doing ring parties, I will come out to your house, kind of like a Tupperware party.
Uh-huh.
And we'll bring the rings out, set them up if you want to have friends come over and do some sweet treats as well as with the rings. Kind of ties it with ring candy, and I love sweets as well. So,
yes.
You know, we'll do little parties for
chocolate and rings, girls. Now, and can I give them your telephone number, or is it best to get a hold of you on your website?
You can contact me through my website. There is two different email addresses on the website, and there's a contact us page.
Okay, then we'll go with that. Remember, it's myringcandy.com. Thank you, Tracy, so much for coming.
Thank you so much.
This has been fun. And we'll be back after this commercial message.
And we're back.
Yes, and that was quite a fun show,
ooh,
I think.
Yeah,
very
yes.
Informative. And I just want to remind everybody again, this Thursday, and that's April 6th, Dr. Michael Rice is going to be at the Senior Center. And
right.
That starts at 7 o'clock. And it's his free seminar on this philosophy of changing your life through getting rid of your old thoughts. Again, the walk, the nature walk, so to speak, for the Tecopa geology, and that's down to these dry lake beds. That's April 16th. Call 760-852-4339. Please go to My Candy, myringcandy.com.
Oh,
this
look at
is
that.
Fun stuff.
Look at that. She's
absolutely
showing
fun
off.
Stuff. What do we got going for next week, Al?
Well, next week we have a lot going on.
Yep.
It's right down here.
Probably too much.
No,
I know,
we got
I can't
14.
Read, but I can't read our lovely producer's handwriting.
Yeah, Dr. Henry Cannon
is
going to be here.
From Canyon
Gate Medical.
Yeah.
Yes. Learn about the prostate cancer, stuff
which
like that.
Which is a very important thing. Especially
yes.
You know, men need to be aware to have their prostate checked
yeah.
as well as their colon.
That's right. The new way to beat those highway blues. Is that right?
How do you
blues?
Do that?
Huh?
Huh? Solar?
Solar energy, SES, high utility rates.
It's to beat your high
utility rates.
But you were so close.
You, what did you say? Highway blues? I told you, nobody can read Pat's writing. It's like...
No, it says utility. It did say utility.
Sounds
but,
like a song to me.
Yeah, but then
that's
this is young
right.
at heart. You know, you must, you know, have a little humor there.
That's absolutely true.
Yeah.
And we're going to be at the Nugget Cooking.
I'm going to cook.
Yay.
One
you're
of my favorite
cook.
Dishes.
Are you going to be the chef?
Who knows? You never
we
know.
We never know.
Yeah.
But we've got so much going on. And again, we so appreciate everybody
being
here. And in our silliness, and sometimes we're serious. And
I am serious.
Yes, you are.
Yes, like most times.
Absolutely.
Except the times that I'm not.
Yes. Again, remember, we got our new month out on the Focus. It's going to be in your mail. And hopefully there's some great coupons in here that you'll be able to utilize throughout the month and have a good time.
That's right.
And all that good stuff.
That's right. She gave us the thing here. You know what that means, don't you?
Yeah. Do you have any funny thing to say to us about why you're a senior?
Yeah. I'm the life of the party, even if it lasts till 8 p.m.
Ha! Great one to leave with. We'll be back next week. We love you. See you next here on Young at Heart.
Bye-bye.
Join Lynn and Al next week for another entertaining and informative hour of Young at Heart. Have a good day.
Fairy tales can come true. It can happen to you.